Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. You're watching Programming with Qt and QML. We've now made it to the integration section. We're going to talk about how we get our values from the C++ level up to the QML level. We'll talk about how we export QObject subclasses. Those QObject subclasses which have properties, export those from C++ up to QML. We'll talk about how we create new elements that do not have a visual appearance. That could be a timer, for example. We have a timer in QML, but our example will nevertheless be a timer just because we were first. We had that in the training material before it was in QML. Can't be bothered changing that. And at the end of this section, we'll talk about how we create new visible QML elements. So how do you create your own element that is not just a composition of other elements on the QML level, but where the painting is done in the C++ level. So we got four very interesting videos coming up here. You already started on the first one, so please do enjoy the ride. We'll start out talking about how do we export a value, just a simple value, from C++ to QML. To do so, we obviously need a C++ application this time. So we've seen in the previous module, we've seen all the engine room stuff that needs to be going on to be able to do this. We've seen the modules before that. We've seen a lot of stuff on the pure QML side where we had no C++ stuff going on. But now we'll merge the two. And that, of course, requires that we have C++ in our application. Actually, this is likely the very last time where you'll just create pure QML application. You will, from this day on, very likely start having a C++ backend in your QML application. And the reason for that is that your application is not going to be a toy application. At least that's my estimate. You've been hanging on so long, so you're likely not going to be just doing very simple hello world kind of application. You connect your application to some backend code that is happening in C++. So to do this, first thing we need is to export the values that we want in QML from C++. To export them, we need to get to the root context. And the root context is like the global namespace in QML. That's the last resort for your QML interpreter when it's trying to look up a value, look in the element, it'll look in the root element, and then at the end, it'll look at the root context. So that's your global variables that you have in QML. We get to that root context simply by going to the engine and asking the engine for the root context. It's actually, today, you could even have said view.rootContext because there is a method on the view that gives you the root context directly, but I just wanted to show you that, hey, we have the engine in there, and it's, of course, the engine itself that knows about the root context. Now, when I have the root context, all I need to do to export a value up to the C++ level is to call setContextProperty, give it a name, and give it a QVariant value. So the names, as you can see here, they all start with an underscore. That's purely a naming convention so that when I'm in the QML file that I'd see something starting with underscore and I know right away, yes, that thing came from a C++ site. So I don't start looking around in my files and where is a string defined? The value over here, as I said, is a QVariant. You've seen that in previous video, what QVariant is about. And you also saw that in those videos that the QVariant class actually has a number of constructors taking different types that are built into Qt Core. So a QString, a QSize, a QColor, I do not need to wrap them in QVariant :: from value. I do not even need to wrap them in QVariant parentheses open, QString, KDAB parentheses close. That's all happening in C++. That's just our regular type conversion in C++. That's all that you need to do on the QML or on the C++ side to export your new values into your QML. On our QML side, I don't need to do anything special. I just use them as if they were regular properties that were in scope one way or the other. So you can see I have a rectangle here. My width and the height of the rectangle simply comes from this size, A size, that I exported from C++. And A size is actually a compound element that has sub-elements in it, namely sub-properties in it, namely width and height. So therefore, width colon underscore A size of width, and similar for height. My background color is, on the other hand, just a regular JavaScript color when we have it up in JavaScript. So color colon underscore background. Now, the key thing in this example really comes down on this line here, where you can see that I print out A size. So you look up here, A size is actually a Q size, 800 comma 600. We could dot our way into it like we did on these two lines, but I can also just print out A size, because behind the scenes, C++ and Qt will know how to convert these combined elements into something that we can use as a string. And let's just run the example here just to see that it actually does exactly what we had. So here is my main again. You can see there isn't really much hidden in the slide. I'm creating my Qt application. I'm setting my source and I'm showing my view so that we can actually see something. And my main.qml, there isn't anything hidden here either, except that I anchor my column inside my rectangle. So here you can see the application running. It is 800 by 600. You'd have to count the pixels on the screen for that to validate it. The background color is gray, as I said in C++. And down here, the size, colon, Q size, 800 comma 600. So that's the string version of that size. As I said, the values that we have in C++, the symbol values that we have in C++, maps to similar symbol values on the QML side. So a number or string will just be a number or string on the QML side. Our combined values that comes, our compound values, that's what I'm supposed to say, the compound values from C++, you can dot your way into them as long as Qt knows about them. If Qt doesn't know about them, then you can still send them up there, but all you can do on the QML side is give them back into the C++, which might still be useful in different situations. But if you want to be able to use your compound values on the C++ side, all you need to do is make them into gadgets. This is a place in the training where I always ask myself, am I really the only one when I see Q underscore gadget that thinks about inspector gadget? So go, go, gadget arm. There we are. Gadgets are not Q objects. So let me move the cursor around for you. Observe here, class person, and then look at those pixels I'm hovering over here. They do not say colon public something. It's just a regular value class. A value class that has these three parameters, as always, it needs a copy constructor, a default constructor, an assignment operator. But once you have those, you can take that and give it to QML, and QML will be able to access its properties. If this syntax here is new for you, then maybe you should rewind and watch the video on properties that we did three videos ago. What it says here is that this gadget, this element, or this object that on the QML side is accessible, it has a name. The name is a QString, and whenever you read that, it actually goes and reads the M underscore name. You can even assign to it to the gadget, but as we'll see in the example below, that value doesn't make it into C++ land again. It's a copy that you get of gadgets onto your QML level. I got another one here, int h, again, member M underscore h. Do notice. If you look at that line again, don't look at my face, look at that line again. Notice it do not say anything about a notification signal. That is only for objects. We'll see that in the next video. But for gadgets, they are a pure copy that you get from your C++ level up to the QML level. The QML level can work with that. It can even update it. But if you want it back into the C++ level, you need to call a setter back on it. So they are really just a copy that you get on. And of course, it also, without the notification signal, means that they will not be able to participate in a property binding, simply because it's a property binding requires that you have notification signals for whenever the value changes. So they really should just be thought of as your queue size that we saw on the previous slide. A queue size has a width and a height, and you can take this size and give it up to the QML level and think of it as if it was just a value, and that is what your gadgets are. To support that the gadget will actually be able to print out, just like our queue size printed out, it printed queue size parentheses open 800, 600 as a string. To be able to support that, we need to create a toString method that returns a queue string. If that method exists, QML or the Qt QML engine will use that whenever you try to stringify your QML value. And that's one thing here on this example we haven't seen before, namely the Q underscore invocable. What that means is that this method should be callable or invocable from the QML's level. So on the QML side, I got a person gadget here now, and because that this method is Q underscore invocable, I can call the toString on that object. Hadn't I had Q underscore invocable, QML wouldn't even know about this, because the meta object information extracted from mock and all of that stuff will only extract information about the Q underscore invocable and slots. I was just about to say and slots, but slots is something that goes along with Q objects. And again, our gadgets are not Q objects. Let's just see this example here in action. So I got my main, my quick application here. I set a context property called underscore Santa. That is a person that is called Santa and is 256 years old. So our person constructor here, as you can see, has name and age. That person, of course, needs to go into a qvariant. So I'll say qvariant colon colon from value. I couldn't just give it as I did with my integer and a size and so on, because there's no qvariant constructor that takes a person. So I need this qvariant colon colon from value to get it up on the QML side. I also export a database here. So my underscore DB is a database, and I'm a bit ahead of myself because that one is a QObject. But it's simply to export something where I can actually access the properties and method later on. Okay, on the QML side, it looks like this. And let me just run the application here. It's a pretty boring application. It has one label that says press me, one text element. And when I click it, it doesn't even do any animation or anything. And it doesn't seem to be doing anything except that, well, on standard output, it prints some stuff. So let's just resize this a bit. There we are. So on standard output, it printed out the stuff. And that's what you can see up here. I got my item here. It has a width and a height, and inside it has a text element. That's a press me and a mouse area where the unclicked says, well, okay, so when I click this, I will do a global lookup initially. So I'll simply console.log my underscore Santa. My underscore Santa says person Santa 256. So that's printing out that my Santa is 256 year old. Now, let me try and get a gadget from the C++ level onto the QML level. So I call this underscore DB, which is my database. It has a method called lookup, and I look up the fake Santa, and I have that in an instance variable here on the, or as a variable here on my QML side. And var Santa equals to looking up fake Santa. I can print him out too, and I do so here. My fake Santa is 65 years old, and it's called fake Santa. I can add a person to the database, so I can create new elements there, but I cannot create, at least not yet, we haven't seen that, and for gadgets I wouldn't even be able to do that, but I can create elements by simply going to the database and say, can you create it, and then give it back right away. So here I call db make person, so I'm creating an instance of Jesper that is 18 years old. If that's me, then I'm afraid that's a slightly an earlier version of me, likely before QML even existed. I create that element there, and it returns that element to the QML level. I give it straight back into the database, into the C++ level by simply calling add person with that gadget that I created there. And now I can look up in the database. I look up Jesper, and looking him up, I print him out, and we can see here that in the database, we got this Jesper version that is 18 years old. On the QML side, I can dock my way into gadgets. As we discussed, Jesper.h equal to 44. And there we have now we'll print that out, and we see we have Jesper that is 44 years old. Again, this is a slightly older example, I'm afraid. Finally, I will go to the database and I will ask for Jesper once again, just to validate that by me updating him on the QML side didn't actually touch the database. So I'll ask for Jesper again, I'll print that out, and we can see that the 18-year-old version of Jesper still exists in the database. So again, gadgets are really truly just values that you copy from the C++ side up to the QML side. You cannot do property bindings with the properties of the gadgets. You can just dot your way into those elements. That's it for this video. In the next video, we will see QObjects being exported. Well, actually a QObject pointer being exported. And that's a complete different story on what you can do with those. So stay tuned. Until then, have a great day.